I'm Neil from Meta, and I'm going to be talking about accelerating builds with Buck2. So Buck2 is a build system. It takes your source files and turns them into object files, binaries, the like of that. It's been developed at Meta for the last 4 years, and it's currently in use at Meta, and I'm from Meta. Coincidences. It supports many programming languages, so C++, Rust, Erlang, OCaml, lots and lots of stuff. And it's designed for large monorepos, but that doesn't mean it's not applicable for smaller repos or for multi-repos. But yeah, it has all the things you need if you do have a large monorepo. It's open source. So bug2.build is our website, and then there's the obligatory GitHub link where you can see all the source code. But perhaps the most coolest thing for the developer experience, productivity experience audience is that it is twice as fast as Buck1. So developers get faster builds. And in this talk, I'll kind of give you an introduction to Buck2, and then talk a little bit about how we get the faster builds. So I would give a demo, but build systems are really boring and live demos really scare me. So I'll show you a screenshot of a demo I did earlier. So it's a build system. So you type something like Buck2 build Buck2, and it'll show you a very pretty console. And here you can see things like it knows which files have changed. It's talking to the network to accelerate things. We've got some catch hits here, and it's building a load of dependencies. And perhaps the interesting thing is I went to build Buck2, and it went and built my dependencies like Buck2 events. How did it know to do that? It knew to do that because I told it to. So I create a targets file in my repo that says, I have a Rust binary called Buck2. Its sources are buck2.rs. And its dependencies are things like the open source third party anyhow Rust library and the Buck events library. And there are about 40 more dependencies down here. And this is written in Starlark, which is a dialect of Python that is deterministic and simple. So let's look at what Buck2 is as an architecture. So right over here, we have the targets that the user writes. These are specific to your project. You say how your project works, written in by the user, specific to each project. And you can use Starlark function to say build slightly nice wrappers so it works the way you want it to work. Then we have the rules. So this says what Rust library is, what Rust binary is, what Rust test is, and the same thing for C++ and Erlang and OCaml, blah, blah, blah. And Meta has a bunch of rules for all the languages we build internally, which we ship and which you can reuse, but which you can also entirely delete and replace with your own language rules. And some people have done so. There's nothing special about these. It's just a way to help you get started. Plus there are rules for things like downloads, run a shell command, aliases, all the kind of good stuff you'd expect. And then we come to Buck2, the binary itself, the core. It's written in Rust because all cool things are written in Rust nowadays. And this is the kind of thing that actually holds the build graph. It knows what's going on. It knows the state. It provides APIs for the rules. So the rule can say what it wants to do and the build graph can go and execute it and elaborate it. You've seen the word Starlark quite a lot. So it includes a Starlark interpreter, which is also released as a separate open source project that you can use separate to Buck2 if you so wish. And this contains things like linters, type checkers, IDE support, all the good stuff you expect in a modern language. It has a library for the console output, the logging, and importantly, we can pack a lot of performance into this thing, which then benefits everyone down there. So it's the DPE conference, so I thought I'd get back to the things that matter. Buck2 is twice as fast as Buck1. Which means, like, in real practical terms, a developer who typically would have spent 10 minutes waiting for their build now spends 5 minutes waiting for their build. And Buck1 was no slouch. It's not, it wasn't terribly slow, but it is now twice as fast. So this is really nice. And furthermore, we were able to look at our population of engineers and find that engineers whose builds were sped up by Buck2 often produced meaningfully more code. So we made their builds go faster. Now they write more code. And as we migrated cohorts, they each kept producing more code. So we can actually get real benefits from moving to a faster build system. So let me go through the five performance features that we added. The first one, abstraction. Bit of a weird thing to start as a performance thing, but abstractions give you a really powerful tool to optimize further later. So Buck1, the real mistake that was made is it was a single Java blob. And in that Java blob, there was a core build system and some language rules, C++, Java, all these. If you wanted to improve the C++ rules, you needed to be an expert in C++, because obviously you want to do something new and clever with the rules. But you also needed to be an expert in the core build system, because it was in the core build system and it used the core build system abstractions. If you wanted to improve the core build system, say you've thought of some fancy new feature, we're going to download less, we're going to compile between toolchains, all these great things, you would have to go and fix every single rule which had reached into the internals of your build system and grabbed at them. And that just basically meant we had to give up improving the core of Buck1. So sometimes people ask, like, will there be a Buck3? No, we fixed the abstraction. We can now iterate on the rules and the core separately, and hopefully we will never need to break this again. The important thing about an API is it should describe what you want, the effect you want to have, not how to do it. So I think a good example here is the write file API. You could imagine implementing a write file API by writing the bytes to disk straight away. And if you write an API where the user can observe what is on the disk somehow, that's the only option you've got. But if you have a more abstract notion of what a file is and you don't let people just arbitrarily read the disk, you can defer the write, so do it later. You can buffer the write and perhaps not do it at all if it is needed. You can write it to disk, but compress. You can upload it to a server. And I'm sure by the time I get back to work, someone will have thought of yet another optimization for write file. And the nice thing is we can try all these things, keep the ones that work, and we can do that without changing any of the libraries. The Starlark Rust also provides a very strong abstraction. There's no accidental leaking between these two. But it does mean that we've had to create powerful APIs, powerful enough to express like really advanced build concepts in the languages. We don't want to cheat and put language for any logic for any specific language in our core. That would violate our rules. The next thing is probably the one you expected, I would say, when I said I was going to optimize the build system. Parallel and incremental, kind of build systems 101. We want to run many things at the same time so we can take advantage of all the cores on the cores on the machine. And if something hasn't changed, we don't want to rebuild whatever hasn't changed. So parallel incremental sounds like a great idea. If you had told me you were going to write a build system, you'd say, yeah, we'll be fully parallel and fully incremental. But no build system really is, apart from perhaps Buck2. So in Buck2, there is a single graph, infinite lazy expanded graph that has computations on it. And when you run the Buck2 command line, it looks at this infinite graph and grabs the node it wants from it, which causes all of the graph to kind of get laid out in memory and for the computation to take place. So that gives us parallelism, because it can traverse the graph in multiple edges at the same time, and incrementality, because it's a graph. Computations on this graph are functions from a key to a value. For example, there might be a key which is read this file, and the value might be the string that is that file on disk. So if you take a look at something like Buck2 build, Buck2, what it does is it says, okay, well, give me the artifact Buck2. Okay, to get that, I need the target Buck2. Okay, to get that, I need to get the directory listing of the directory, that's it. And then I need to grab the targets file, the Starlark evaluation of the targets file, which requires the source of the targets file. So you can think we've just built this big graph in the sky, and we just keep plucking at it. And that means that we can have things like parallelism and incrementality everywhere. Well, we said parallelism and incrementality is great. Let's have more of that, more parallelism, more incrementality. And we do that by using a remote server. So we're compatible with the Bazel remote execution API. and we store files in the cloud and we run commands on the cloud. Everyone can reuse the same commands if they've already been computed, and you can run thousands of things at once. Well, once you've made everything else faster, you're going to get bottlenecked by your disk, because most computers have 70 odd cores and one disk, maybe two. So we do a bunch of tricks, like if you're going to run 1,000 compiles remotely and then a linker remotely, well, why bother downloading the 1,000 files? Yeah, that's a complete waste of time. We'll just download the final output of the linker. We also integrate with the Eden file system from Meta, optionally. And then you can have your file system, input file system backed by version control. And you can avoid even downloading the files when you do a git checkout. Important for really large repos. The final trick is really a problem to avoid. So if you have a big enough repo and you look at the repo, you are toast. And that means things like checking the mod time of every file is just hilariously slow. Like, we're talking minutes. So we have to do things like iNotify and Watchman, which is kind of like an iNotify wrapper, to see which files have changed so we can quickly invalidate things. We have to be very careful to stick to the subset of the repo that we care about. Okay, so you're probably thinking at this point, well, there's no way you could not be thinking, I must switch to Buck2 and I must do it tonight. So like all complicated decisions, the answer is probably maybe rather than yes. There's some good and some bad. And, you know, full disclosure, I'm going to go through the bad. But the good first. It's a powerful modern build system that has a lot of good features that we think should be ubiquitous in build systems. There's the performance, but there's also more expressive power that Buck2 provides that I haven't gone through. It's actively developed. There is a team at Meta working on it as I speak. And it is open source in a meaningful way. So if I commit it internally, it goes upstream to GitHub in 15 minutes. If you put up a PR, we will merge it. We will sync it back. All good. And while the remote execution server, we have written a wrapper for the Google remote execution API for external. Everything else is exactly as internal. We use the same Buck that you use. But the bad. Changing build systems is hard. I don't recommend it. There is wins to be had, but be careful before you get yourself into it. Buck2 is fairly new. All new things have teething problems. If you start using it today, you'll have teething problems. If everyone in this room started using it, by the time we got to the back half of the room, I'm sure most of those teething problems would be gone. Some of the rules don't work open source yet, particularly the Java, Android, and iOS rules. But we're working on fixing that. If that is the thing that is stopping you, come see me and we'll see what we can do. And there's no package manager integration. We live in a monorepo world where we've fended in all dependencies. So we're a bit weak there. And we're trying to change the bad. And if you're interested in kind of talking to us more, I'm here all the time. But also some of the Buck team will be at the EngFlow event in Iceland before BaselCon, at the BaselCon Community Day, and at BaselCon itself. And any questions?